Hey folks, how's it going? Welcome to another video. You can see behind me a range of colourful tents. We've got tents of all shapes and sizes. And in this video, we're going to be diving into what makes a good backpacking tent and how to choose one that's going to see you through all of your adventures. When it comes to choosing a backpacking tent or a shelter of any kind, there's a lot of different things to consider. How many people can use it, the season you want to use it in, your budget, how much does it weigh, the design of the shelter, whether you're looking at a bivy and a tarp sort of setup or a tent itself, we're going to cover all of that in this video. For some people, they have decided or identified that weight is their number one priority. And actually, before we jump into the tents themselves, there are a number of different shelter systems you might want to go with that are on the lighter side. And the first place to start with that is a bivy. So here I have a very popular Alp kit bivy, and essentially all it is a piece of material you put around you and your sleeping bag and your roll mat sometimes as well. And then literally you can just lie down anywhere and sleep if that's what makes a good night's sleep for you. So you can get just literally fabric bivvies like this, or you can get one with a hoop design over the head, so it's a little bit like a mini tent, or you know, potentially a coffin, depending on your opinion. And some people like to partner bivvies with a tarp, so essentially again another big sheet of fabric that you tie between trees or two objects, so you've got a little bit of a shelter or roof over your head. So if you're really looking to pack light, a bivvy and a tarp system might be the place you want to start. For some people, they might decide that actually a bivy is just a bit too exposed, and having a wall around you makes you feel a little bit more comfortable and helps you get a better night's sleep. But weight is still really important. And this is where something like a walking pole tent can come in handy. Now, these are definitely, it seems, much more popular in the USA than here in the UK. But again, they can be single skin or double skin, so one layer of fabric or two layers of fabric, and super light fabric that essentially use your walking poles, which you've got with you anyway because you're out hiking, as the main reinforcing structures for the tents. And of course, that is going to help you save a lot of weight because you're not carrying additional tent poles, and it's just going to help keep things nice and light on your back.
Double wall tents are often warmer, more robust, and offer a greater level of comfort over single wall tents. These are definitely one of the most commonly used tents out and about on the trail.
For some people, such as myself, pitch type is something that's really important and something to consider. The first thing with pitch type is it an inner pitch first or is it an outer pitch first? Now, depending on your climate, this may or may not even be important, but certainly here in the UK, I am not one to choose an inner pitch first because very often, I mean, probably 7 or 8 times out of 10, I'm putting my tent up in the rain. And if I'm putting the inner piece of fabric up before the outer piece of fabric, this can get wet and mean everything else gets wet, and it just dampens the experience. Whereas here we have an outer pitch first tent, so essentially this fly sheet is waterproof, and we're going to be getting into fabrics in a minute, but I can literally get in there without even attaching the inner, and I can use that as my shelter if I want to, but otherwise it's waterproof. I can put everything up nice and easy and hopefully things stay dry. Another thing to consider when it comes to the pitch type is whether it's freestanding, partially freestanding, or it needs guy lines to help it stand up, otherwise it's just going to be a flop of fabric. So the majority of tents I tend to find, certainly within the 2 and 3 season range, are partially or not at all freestanding. So as you can see here, they've got a pole reinforcement, so they might just about stay up with the pole, but they need the pegs and the guy lines to keep them up. Whereas here we've got the Southern Cross 1, which is a Terra Nova tent. As you can see, it's freestanding. I can literally pick it up and go for a hike. Just like this.
Freestanding tents have a lot of great features, such as being easy to put up, simple to move around, and providing great protection against strong winds. However, they are often much heavier and bulkier to carry.
Pegs and guy lines are important to some people. Now, for a lot of people, it's not going to be a deal breaker because you can customize things. But essentially, guy lines are these. These are the ropes that are coming out of your tent. And these are certainly, for anything other than freestanding tents, going to be really, really important to help with the structure of your tent. So the design of a guy line is something you might want to consider, but it's definitely not something to get hung up over. And speaking of hung up over things. Pegs, let's talk about them a little bit, if I can actually unhook this. Here we go. So many of the cheaper tents come with very standard pegs like this. And a lot of people end up swapping them out because actually they're quite heavy. They tend to bend. They're really not very robust. So if you want to evolve your peg setup, you can end up with something like this, which is a DAC Featherlight peg. It's got a V shape, as you can see, so you can pop it in the ground at your sort of 45 degree angle, and it's going to have a lot more resistance. Again, other brands of tents have different poles. This is a Berghaus peg, pretty much the same, but different. And it's silver, really, really light. So if you are looking to minimize the weight of your tent, but you haven't got much of a budget to play with, you can buy a slightly cheaper tent, and then you can add some pegs that are a bit fancier at a later date. This one hasn't left my hand yet. Come to the carnival near you. It's definitely worth us diving into for a short while why some tents are so much more expensive than others. And generally speaking, you know, the reason why is because you pay more money for lighter technologies. That can be in the poles and that can be in the fabric. So here we have a Terranova Laser Compact 1. So this is an award-winning tent. It's one of their lightest setups. It's used for adventure racing. And the poles here are aluminium, whereas other tents have fiberglass, which are really heavy, and anything beyond a certain degree that, you know, they're at risk of snapping. In the wind, they're at risk of snapping. Whereas these guys are going to hold up a lot better in more adverse weather conditions. And now let's dive into the fabrics.
Cheaper tents often use coated polyester, which is DWR treated. It is usually less robust and wears away quickly with use. Polyurethane is what they use to coat the tents. Pricier tents often use coated silicone nylon, which is lighter, more robust, and slippier, so it works better in heavy rain. The issue is it can be hard to seal, and often seams aren't taped, but rather the fabrics are manufactured in a way to reduce leakage. Another issue of silicone nylon is that it can stretch when it's wet. So you peg your tent out nice and tight, you deal with a downpour, and then you have to go back out into the rain to tighten those guy lines. Hilleberg tents are rather special. They're triple coated, which makes them so much stronger and more robust. Mid-price tents basically tend to utilise a mixture of the two, using silicone nylon coating on the outside and polyurethane on the inside. Of course, it's also worth me mentioning about Dyneema, which is the lightest, strongest, and most waterproof fabric on the market. Basically, it's Cuban fibre, which doesn't stretch when it gets wet. It's easy to repair, but the issue is, it's very, very expensive. The final thing to think about with regards to fabrics is the denier, which is basically a measure of the weight and thickness of the fabric. The higher the denier number, the more robust, sturdy, and tear-proof that fabric is going to be. That's why the ground sheets often have a higher denier than the fly sheets.
Whether you want a one-person tent or a two-person tent as a solo hiker is completely up to you, because basically some people like a two-person tent for their solo adventures because it just gives them more space to handle all of their kit when you're in your tent for a number of days, particularly in wet conditions. However, a two-person tent seems logical for two people, but again, some people just find it too claustrophobic. Essentially, what I'm trying to say here is really try before you buy. Make a list of a number of tents that interest you, they meet your criteria, and then go to a store and try them out. Apparently, though, this tent is a worn dog tent. There's no room for me. Bobby, can I come in? Please? Generally speaking, two people in a tent, you do end up spooning at some point. But joking aside, another reason to try before you buy is for the length. Some people are really surprised by how short some tents are. So if you're on the taller side, definitely get in those tents and make sure you actually fit. For some people, now I'm not looking at myself here, but for some people, there are particular features in a tent which are really important. Let's start with the porch. This here was my first ever backpacking tent. Thank you, Argos. It's rather nice, actually. I haven't been in this for many years. But you can see down here that basically my rucksack only just and just fits. It has a tiny little porch. If I was to hike for multiple days with my rucksack, with my boots, with my waterproofs, and they're all wet and soggy, then basically there is not much space. However, some of my current tents that I use, such as the Hilleberg Acto, Hilleberg Ennen, Terra Nova Laser Compact 1, reeling off all the jargon, there is loads of space in the porch for a rucksack, for boots, for cooking and stove systems, for wet waterproofs. And that's really important for somebody like me who likes to have the space to spread out. So porch is certainly something to consider. It's rather snug in here. Anyway, I'm in here because I want to show you this. This, my friends, is the wonderful invention called a pocket. Many tents have a pocket, and the best thing about them is you put things in them. Helps keep things organized. But on a slightly more serious note, something you really might want to consider when it comes to looking at a tent is ventilation. Now, tents can be prone to condensation in particular environments and weather conditions, and condensation is essentially where you get moisture forming on the inside of the tent. It can ruin a trip, at least for me anyway. So when your tent has more mesh like this all around me, essentially it's more breathable. It means the air I'm breathing out is going to be able to escape into the atmosphere and duck underneath that fly sheet and get out the way and not cause water droplets. When you're looking at four-season tents though, so those more robust tents, they tend to have less mesh, so therefore there's less ventilation, and often the fly sheet comes right down to the ground. They want to keep out snow flurries and rainfall, so it certainly has a purpose, but it can mean if you use it in the wrong conditions, you get more condensation. So again, just looking at the design of the tent for the season and the location that you want to use it in should hopefully help you have a more comfortable trip. To wrap this thing up, I think it's really worth mentioning that actually buying secondhand can be an awesome way to go. Especially if something like this, a Hilleberg Acto, is your dream and ideal tent. Heading onto a site like Outdoor Gear Exchange on Facebook just might be a solution. Post a friendly post and someone can come along and be like, oh hey, I bought one of those, didn't quite get on with it, so here it is for a couple of $100 less. Ideal. It's also worth me mentioning that supporting high street stores is an amazing thing to do. Most of us have a small independent outdoor store nearby. So pop in there, shake some hands, make some friends, and make a purchase, and you'll be supporting the future of independent stores near you. That's it from me, guys. I have a few tents to put away, but I want to say thank you so much for watching. I hope this has been helpful and informative and broken down the potentially slightly complex and baffling world of buying a backpacking tent into a much simpler platform. Until next time, enjoy all of your adventures and stay wild.